Hi, I'm Reverend David Clark and I welcome you this morning to Malvern Baptist Church online. We begin our service today with a psalm, Psalm 95. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, and he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. We shall sing now, Jesus shall take the highest honour. Say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who have sinned against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Let's sing again, there is a hope.
Thank you. test of time that lifts my eyes beyond the beckoning breath to see the matchless beauty of a day divine when I behold his face. When
continue our Bible study series in the book of Hebrews, looking at Jesus, our anchor of hope. And this morning our reading is taken from Hebrews chapter 3. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your enduring word. We pray now, Lord, that as I speak, Lord, you would speak to each one of us. Therefore, holy brothers, who share in the heavenly calling, fix your thoughts on Jesus, the apostle and high priest whom we confess. He was faithful to the one who appointed him, just as Moses was faithful in all God's house. Jesus has been found worthy of greater honour than Moses, just as the builder of a house has greater honour than the house itself. For every house is built by someone, but God is the builder of everything. Moses was faithful as a servant in all God's house, testifying for what would be said in the future. But Christ is faithful as a son over God's house, and we are his house, if we hold on to our courage and the hope of which we boast. So, as the Holy Spirit says, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did in the rebellion during the time of testing in the desert, where your fathers tested and tried me and for 40 years saw what I did. That is why I was angry with that generation. And I said, their hearts are always going astray and they have not known my ways. So I declared an oath in my anger, they shall never enter my rest. See to it, brothers, that none of you has a sinful, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God. But encourage one another daily, as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be deceived, hardened by sin's deceitfulness. We have come to share in Christ if we hold firmly till the end the confidence we first had. As has just been said, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did in the rebellion. Who were they who heard and rebelled? Were they not all those who Moses led out of Egypt? And with whom was he angry for 40 years? Was it not with those who sinned, whose body fell in the desert? And to whom did God swear that they would never enter his rest, if not to those who disobeyed? So we see that they were not able to enter because of their unbelief. If you were a sailor on a sailing ship and you saw a crew member fall over the edge into the sea, your job was to rush to the side rails, calling out loudly, "Man overboard," and to keep that man in the water fixed in your sight while pointing to him. Others would then throw a line or a life belt over the side and perhaps launch a boat over the side to rescue the man. But you had to keep that man fixed in view in the rolling seas. Sometimes we can get so wrapped up in life, its problems, its tasks, its joys, that we lose sight of the main aim. The first line of Rick Warren's massive Christian bestseller, The Purpose-Driven Life, is, "It's not about you." That's the first line of the first chapter we which is it all starts with God. The writer to the Hebrews calls his readers, which includes us, to fix our eyes on Jesus, not the church or even Christian things, but Jesus. We must not lose sight of Jesus. The writer begins by comparing Jesus with Moses using Old Testament illustrations. The readers of this book of Hebrews were largely Jewish converts to Jesus. And to them, Moses was the most respected figure in Jewish history. But the writer says that Jesus is worthy of more honour than Moses. And he does this by a meditation on the dual concept of the word house. The first meaning of the word house is the physical construct, the bricks and the mortar. And the nation of Israel is compared to a great house built out of stone and wood. Moses was there at the foundation of the nation as it was built through the Exodus experience. Moses was a founding father of this nation, but he was still part of the nation of Israel. But it was Jesus, as part of the Godhead, who was builder of the nation, who called Israel, including Moses, into being. So the writer says, the builder of the house deserves greater honour than the house itself. Think of the great houses of England, Buckingham Palace. It was not built to honour itself, but the Duke of Buckingham. And Blenheim Palace, again built to honour the military achievements of the Duke of Marlborough. The second meaning of house is the honourable family who live in the big house, as in the Royal House of Windsor, who live in Windsor Castle. You see, Moses was called by God at the burning bush, and he was sent to rescue God's house, Israel. And he was faithful to God as a steward over that house. But remember, right at the beginning of chapter 1, the writer calls Jesus the Son of God, the exact representation of his glory. And just as Prince Charles, as son of the Queen, has a greater status and honour in the House of Windsor than the Queen's butler, Jesus, as the faithful son appointed by God over his house, is greater than the servant Moses, however faithful Moses was as a servant. The writer then goes on to say to his readers, and as by extension us, and we are his house, the new Israel. But he adds a caveat, if we hold on to our courage and the hope of which we boast. You see, because there's a danger. And the writer gives a warning from Moses' time. As a quote from Psalm 95, which is part of the Sabbath liturgy in the synagogues, which the readers would have known backwards. And the writer attributes this to the Holy Spirit, and he says, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did in the rebellion during the time of testing in the desert. Don't harden your hearts to God's voice. Don't rebel against him. Rather, firstly, hear the word of God. And believe the word of God. See to it none of you has a simple, unbelieving heart. And obey the word of God. Don't turn away in rebellion from the living God. And share the word of God. But encourage one another daily as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. And then lastly, hold fast to Jesus in courage, hope, confidence, and persistence. He says in verse 14, we have come to share in Christ if we hold firmly till the end the confidence we had at first. And he repeats it in verse 6, and we are his house if we hold on to our courage and the hope of which we boast. You see, the Hebrews were under persecution. They were in danger of falling away back into Judaism, be it mainstream Judaism or mystical Judaism. The writer says, don't be tempted to go back to Egypt like your doomed forefathers were tempted. because Jesus is superior to these alternatives. He's superior to Moses, i.e. the law and to Judaism. And your place of safety is not in the Jewish synagogue, but in the house of God, the family of the church. And this is true for us too. We must firstly hear the word of God. My wife reckons that I have a kind of a selective hearing that somehow manages to tune her out much of the time. And similarly, you know, we can read the Bible, we can scan the words, but somehow think it applies to someone else. Secondly, we must believe the words of God. And not just believe it in our heads, but believe it in our hearts. I love the illustration of Blondin. Blondin, back at the end of the 19th century, was the most famous tightrope walker of his time, perhaps of ever. His party trick was to walk across Niagara Falls on a high wire without a safety rope. And as part of his act, what he would do was then push a wheelbarrow across Niagara Falls. And then he would say, "Who believes that I can walk across Niagara Falls pushing someone in the wheelbarrow?" And of course, nobody would volunteer to go in, apart from his manager. A lot of people, you know, would believe in their heads that Blondin could walk across Niagara Falls pushing someone in a wheelbarrow, but they wouldn't believe enough to stake their life on it, apart from the manager. See, that's the difference between head belief and real faith. Do you trust your life to Jesus enough to live your life according to his commandments? We must believe the word of God enough to change our lifestyle. Thirdly, obey the word of God. Don't rebel. One of the Old Testament words for sin is pressure, which means to shake the fist at God. I like the illustration there. Concept of shaking the fist in rebellion against God. We mustn't do that. Fourthly, we must share the word of God, but encourage one another daily. Don't criticize others, but build them up. How often? Now and again? No, the writer says daily. Who can we encourage daily? Fifthly, we should hold fast to Jesus in courage, hope, confidence, and persistence. Christian life is like a marathon race. It's finishing well that really counts. So the question is, are you finishing well? Billy Graham wrote a book towards the end of his life addressing the challenges of old age called Finishing Well. I'm sure it's available through good bookshops, including the Littleton Well, isn't it, John? We must hold firmly to Jesus and his promises if we want our share in Christ. And by that I mean our eternal inheritance. Now some of you might say, is this not salvation by works? Does our salvation depend upon our own efforts? No. But I think there is this tension. I think going back to our man overboard illustration, now, if the man falls overboard, the crew on the ship will launch the lifeboat. And when that man is rescued, you know, he has to stay inside the boat. He has to hold on tight to the grab rails rather than trust his salvation to the icy seas and his ability to swim. He is safe in the boat, but he must remain in the boat and trust the captain of the lifeboat to return him to the ship. And similarly in our lives, the captain of our boat is Jesus. Now he has rescued us, but we must stay in that safe boat, holding on to Jesus. The motto of Spurgeon's College is Et Tenio, Et Tenior. which translated means I hold and am held. Spurgeon said, our desire is that every man may both hold the truth and be held by it, especially the truth of Christ crucified. Harris says, this speaks of the paradox of grace. We are found and rescued by grace and grace alone. There is nothing we can do to earn our salvation. We are totally dependent on the mercy of God and the cross of Christ. Yet, we must still hold on to the grace that God has shown us. Hold on to it and hold it out to others. Jesus, speaking in John 15, says, I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burnt. We must stay close to Jesus. We must hold on to him and the offer of his salvation. The comfort, you know, in this is that Jesus is over us as the faithful one, the good shepherd, the faithful servant. His job it is to bring us safely to the Father. And he will not abandon us. He will not let go of us. We are safe in his grip. The writer then repeats the warning. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did in the rebellion. And why does he repeat this warning? He says, who were they who heard and rebelled? Were they not all those whom Moses led out of Egypt? What he's saying is this could happen to anyone. See, those who followed Moses were part of the chosen race. They have had a shared experience of the Passover and the crossing of the Red Sea. You know, they'd witnessed an incredible miracle together. They'd all been through those piled up waters together. And yet, because of rebellious unbelief, nearly all failed to reach the promised land and they suffered death in the desert. There's a big "or you" to each one of us. There's a real danger that each one of us can develop a sinful, unbelieving heart. Now, I don't believe that we can lose our salvation. But I whisper it. It may be possible, just possible, that we could throw it away in rebellion. We can certainly lose our subjective peace with God. One understanding of this is, that's one understanding of losing our Sabbath rest. And the antidote then for this is to firstly fix our thoughts on Jesus as the superior Son. And don't follow the tempting alternatives. For us, it's unlikely to be Judaism. But maybe we want to skip church now and again. We want to go shopping. Or we want to skip growth group and watch TV. Or we want to skip prayer and do some DIY or cleaning or whatever floats our boat. We need to fix our thoughts on Jesus, the superior Son. And we need to hold on fast to Jesus because he's holding on to us. And we need to encourage one another daily. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you, Jesus, our Saviour, that you reached down and you rescued us. And you brought us into a spacious place. Lord, I pray that by your grace we would not stray from your presence, but instead we would fix our eyes on you. We're going to sing our final song, You're the Word of God the Father.
You're the Word of God the Father, from before the world began. Every star and every planet has been fashioned by your hand. All creation holds together by the power of your voice. Let the skies declare your glory. Let the land and seas rejoice. You're the author of creation. You're the Lord of every man. And your cry of love rings out across the land. Yet you left the gaze of angels, came to see and save the lost, and exchanged the joy of heaven for the anguish of the cross. With a prayer you fed the hungry, with a word you stilled the sea. Yet how silently you suffered, that the guilty may go free. You're the author of creation, you're the Lord of every man. And your cry of love rings out across the land. With a shout you rose victorious, wresting victory from the grave. And ascended into heaven, leading captives in your way. Now you stand before the Father, interceding for your own. From each tribe and tongue and nation, you are leading sinners home. You're the author of creation, you're the Lord of every man. And your cry
today, O Lord, I yield myself to you. May your will be my delight today. May you have perfect sway in me. May your love be the pattern of my living. I surrender to you my hopes, my dreams, my ambitions. Do with them what you will, when you will, as you will. I place into your loving care my family, my friends, my future. Care for them with a care that I can never give. I release into your hands my need to control, my craving for status, my fear of obscurity. Eradicate the evil, purify the good, and establish your kingdom on earth for Jesus' sake. Amen.
Thou forever near me, my say.